Yeah, let's start by talking about the confusion matrix. So yeah, I also should say this lecture, I didn't make any particular lecture notes. One of the reasons is that towards the end of the semester, there are always so many things to do, for example, making the final exam. The other reason is that I wrote about most of it in the Python machine learning book in chapter 6. So I will be sharing chapter 6 with you as on Canvas, which you can use then as reference material for this lecture. Also for this lecture, I think most of the concepts are pretty straightforward, so that you probably don't need to read up much of it. And so it should be probably all, or most of it should be self-explanatory. So the concepts this week are not particularly complicated. So what is a confusion matrix? So we will start by looking at the classic case of a 2x2 confusion matrix. Traditionally, this was also called contingency matrix. I actually don't know where the word confusion matrix comes from. I mean, maybe because it's confusing to take a look at it. However, I think maybe one of the reasons could be that it's kind of showing us which class labels a machine learning classifier confuses. So what is a confusion matrix showing us? It's the actual class labels versus the predicted class labels. So what do I mean by actual class labels? By those I mean the true labels in the data set. So in a supervised classification context, or sometimes we also call them the ground truth labels. So these are the true labels in our dataset that we want to predict, and we compare them to the actual prediction of a classifier. So we look at this in the context of classification. And for example, in a traditional sense, we have usually a positive class. For example, if you think of spam classification, spam is nothing positive, but we could, for example, say positive class is spam and negative is not spam. So a spam email is nothing positive in a way that it's not good. However, the positive class is usually the class that we want to predict. So the class where we have a stronger focus on. So if we are concerned with spam classification, we can say spam is our positive class. And then we can look at the confusion matrix. So here for P spam, it's the actual spam. And here the P means whether we predict if it's the positive class, whether it's spam. So what I mean is the number of true positives here. True positives mean spam email that were actually correctly identified as spam. So spam identified as spam. And the false negatives then, this would be, so a negative is not spam, right? So a false negative would be then spam email predicted as not spam. So the reason is, so why is it a false negative? So not spam is here the negative class, but we make a false prediction. So the false of this, you can think of it as flipping it. So flipping not spam to the other label, it's spam. So we predict spam as not spam. Then we have the false positives. So what are the false positives? So the false positives are the not spams predicted as spam. And then the true negatives, it's the remaining part, it's the not spam email correctly predicted as not spam. So yeah, and the ones where we make correct predictions, these are the true ones, either the true negatives or the true positives. And from those, we can also then predict or compute the classification error and the classification accuracy. So for example, when we compute the classification accuracy, we look at the correct predictions and divide it by the number of total predictions. So we compute the correct predictions, the true positives and true negatives, and divide it by all the data points here. This is like the sum of all the data points, and then from that we can compute the error as 1 minus the accuracy. Or vice versa, we can take a look at the wrong predictions. So we can take a look at these wrong predictions and divide this by the total number of predictions, and this gives us the classification error. So in that way, the error is 1 minus the accuracy, and the accuracy is 1 minus the error. So this is like the basic concept of a confusion matrix. Yeah, let's now see how we can make a confusion matrix using the tools that we discussed in this class so far, like Python, scikit-learn, MLExtend, and so forth. And for that, we will be working with a new data set. So we will be working with a breast cancer Wisconsin data set, so a local Wisconsin data set here. In that case, we have a lot of columns this time, actually up to 32 columns. So what are these columns? The first column, I just see this should be first and not third. The first column is an ID number for the patient ID. So this first column is the patient ID, and that is some information that is not really telling us anything about the cancer. So this is something we would not want to include in our classifier as information. So we will just forget about the ID column here. The second column stores the corresponding cancer diagnoses. So for example, whether a cancer is malignant or benign, these are our class labels. And then the remaining columns, 3 to 32, contain features that were extracted from digitized images of the nuclei of the cancer cells. So for those, these are then encoding information about the tumors or cancer. And we can use these for our classifier to predict whether the cancer is benign or malignant. I should note, this is, a typical example of a traditional or conventional machine learning, where there are certain techniques for extracting information. So this is this includes feature extraction that has been done beforehand, so that we have this tabular data set. So it's a data set table, and the data has been extracted from digitized images. In the context of deep learning, for example, instead of machine learning, in deep learning we would design a neural network that would also that would automatically extract these features from the image. So we would feed the images directly to a deep learning classifier. So deep learning is a topic that is covered in STAT 453 in spring, where we would, for example, directly feed these images to the deep learning classifier. The downside of that is that it would require way more data than we may have. So this would usually require thousands to millions of images to perform or to get a good performance. In traditional machine learning, depending on how much information our features encode, usually we can get away with fewer examples, but we have we assume the features have already been extracted. Anyways, let's not get distracted by deep learning, but focus on this problem here. So if you want to have also more information about this data set, it's also on the UCI machine learning repository. So this is a data repository that contains or collects many open source data sets. It's also a good source for finding good benchmark data sets. So what we do first is we convert our class labels, the strings M and B for benign and malignant, into integer class labels. So we will be using the label encoder from scikit-learn and transform these labels. So M will be then encoded as class label 1, and B will be encoded as class label 0. And usually this is like alphabetically, because B comes from M. So scikit-learn does this usually alphabetically. Also, if we don't provide further context, we will be looking at precision recall functions later on. We can set a positive label for those, but if we don't specify the positive label, if you think back of the confusion matrix where we have the positive classes and then the negative classes, by default in scikit-learn, class label 1 will be positive. So class label 1 will be positive and 0 will be the negative by default. However, so now it gets tricky. So my confusion matrix was with a positives here. So in this context of scikit-learn and ML-extend, you can you have to think a little bit differently. You have to think about the class labels ordered. Even though the one is the positive label in scikit-learn and ML-extend, it will be numerically ordered because things are usually ordered. So you will have 0 for the negative class here in the confusion matrix, and then 1 for the positive class like before. But notice that the true positives are now in the lower right corner and the true negatives are in the upper left corner. This is usually how scikit-learn and ML-extend display these class labels. Why is that? Because we will also see we can extend the concept of a confusion matrix to multiple classes, where we, for example, have in the, for example, Iris dataset case, we have 3 classes, 0, 1, and 2. So then we don't have positive and negative notions, we have just 0, 1, and 2, and then everything is nicely ordered. Okay, anyway, so it's maybe too much information at this point. I just wanted to say the scikit-learn and ML-extend confusion matrices will give you the true positives in the lower right corner and the true negatives in the upper left corner. So everything is ordered by class labels. Okay, so what we then do is we split the data set into a training and a test set. So we have 80% for the training set and 20% for testing. And now we are going to plot the confusion matrix. So here we are going to use k-nearest neighbor classifier. As you recall, for k-nearest neighbor classifiers, it's important to scale the features. So we also have a standard scaler, and we combine them using the pipeline that we talked about before. We will be using the confusion matrix from ML-extend instead of scikit-learn because it has some extra feature that I want to show you after that. But ultimately, in this data case, they will give you exactly the same results. If you uncomment this one and use the scikit-learn one instead, you will get the same results. So recall, this is our true positives and this is our true negatives in this case. So what we are doing here is we're fitting the k-nearest neighbor classifier, then predicting the examples, and then calling the confusion matrix on the true labels. So these are our true labels. And these are our predicted labels. And we can see the true negatives are in this case 71 and the true positives in this case are 39. So here is a visualization of that confusion matrix, the array that I showed you on the previous slide, using the plot confusion matrix function from ML-extend. So this is taking as input the confusion matrix, the array, and visualizes the confusion matrix using matplotlib under the hood. So here, like I said, the class labels will be sorted in ascending order, increasing order. So the lowest class label comes first, class label 0, and then class label 1 here. And if we have, like before, where we have class label 0 as benign and class label 1 as malignant tumor, then we define the malignant tumor as the positive class. I mean, this is arbitrary. We can also consider the benign tumor as positive class. It's really application specific, but let's say we go with a convention using class label 1 as the positive class, then this one would be our true positive here, this box, and this box would be our true negatives. So there's also a function in ML-extend's confusion matrix function. There's a parameter called showAbsolute and another parameter showNormed and another parameter for the color bar. So it gives you some more options. So showAbsolute, this is by default true. It shows you the absolute number, so the 39 true positives and the 71 true negatives here, so 71 and 39 like before. The relative one, so the normed one, is shown below. This is like normed per row. So what you can see here for the true label 0, 99% are the true negatives, and then 1% are the false positives. So why false positive? Because we predict it to be positive, however it's not a positive, so that's a false positive, and this would be the false negatives then. So 7% are false negative for class label 1, and 93% for the true label for the positives ones are actually the true positives. So it's just an additional option, and then you can also have this color bar here if you like. This can be helpful if you have a larger confusion matrix with multiple classes, more than two classes, and it can be sometimes helpful to have a color bar there too. Yeah, so now based on the confusion matrix, we can compute other metrics. So we have a confusion matrix from which we can compute metrics. So what we have is the true positive rate, the false positive rate, the false negative rate, and the true negative rate. Why the stars here? That's just to remind myself, to remind you that these will be relevant later again when we compute or talk about the receiver operator characteristic, which is a very common and popular metric in machine learning. So, but now what we are going to talk about first is briefly these true positive rates, just to explain you where that comes from. So let's go back and consider a confusion matrix. Let's say we have the positives and the negatives here for the, let's put the predicted ones here, predicted positive and negative, and then the true or actual, let's call it actual labels, positive and negative. So when you think back of the table or confusion matrix we had before, the true positives were here, and this here is the number of positives. So the number of actual positives can be broken down into the true positives and the false negatives. So if we want to compute the true positive rate, for example, we would take this number here, the true positives, and divide it by the total number of positives, which is then basically the true positives plus the false negatives. So if we have, let's say, 100 positives, and this value here, the true positives are, let's say, 30, then our true positive rate is 30 over 100, so 33.3%, for example. And we can also then, using the similar idea, we can compute these other metrics. So in practice, so what metric do we care most about? I mean, it really depends on the case or the problem at hand. For example, if you think back of our spam classification example, where the true positives is like predicting spam as spam, the false positives was like predicting non-spam as spam, false negatives would be then spam as non-spam, and true negatives would be non-spam as non-spam. So what is more, what is something we would be mostly interested in? So I would say increasing the true positive rate is great. So if we increase the true positive rate, we increase the probability of predicting spam if it's actually spam, right? So that's a good thing. I think what we really want to avoid though in a spam classification example, if we have to pick over true positive and false positive rate, we will later see there's like a small relationship between the two, so they're kind of tied together. So if what's more important, like improving the true positive rate or decreasing the false positive rate, if I have to pick one over the other, I would maybe in the spam classification example emphasize the decreasing the false positive rate, right? Because if you think back of the false positive, this is non-spam classified as spam. And now think about it from a user experience. If you have an email inbox, it can be super annoying if you have spam in your inbox, right? So if you have case where you have spam in your inbox where the classifier didn't really classify spam as spam, this would be annoying. So if you have a lower true positive rate, that would be annoying because you have a lot of spam in your email inbox. However, it's not the end of the world. You can always click the delete button. However, how I use my email, I usually almost never look at my spam email. And now imagine you have a high false positive rate. That means the classifier predicts something is a spam, although it's not a spam. So it gets automatically moved to your spam email box. And then imagine that's like a very important question, like something about your grade, or you asked me an important question about the exam, and I don't get to see it because it's now in the spam box. So this would be really bad, right? So in that way, I think in the spam classification example, if I would pick one over the other, maximizing true positive rate or minimizing false positive rate, I would pick minimizing false positive rate and be okay if there are sometimes spam email in my inbox. I can just manually delete them. Of course, ideally we would have a low false positive rate and a high true positive rate, but it's not always possible. So here's an illustration of that issue. So what I was trying to visualize here is that it's not always possible to have, let's say, zero or false positive rate and very good true positive rate. So there's usually a trade-off. So consider this case, we have one feature and because we talked about spam, let's continue talking about spam. So let's say you have some numeric measure, what makes a spam and not a spam. So here on the left-hand side, the negative class, you have all the spam emails. So you have some numerical feature here for those, and there's a high density of those in the center, and it's basically a distribution of the feature values. So you have a lot of examples. So each X here is one training example, and here the same for my spam email. So I have also a lot of spam email, and it goes up to here. So not that many, but here is the density of that. So relatively how many fall into that region for each feature. And you can now see it's not possible based on that feature to make a perfect prediction, right? So because there's an overlap between non-spam and spam. They have some of them have have similar features, so in this region here. So it's not possible to distinguish between the two. So if I have a decision threshold here, this is my decision boundary. If I say everything left of my decision threshold is predicted as negative, and everything right of my decision threshold is predicted as positive, as spam. So I will get that correct prediction most of the time, because you can see the bulk of positive classes here is actually to the right, so there's a high density here, and the bulk of the negative class here is to the left. However, I will make some wrong predictions, right? So if I predict everything left from the decision boundary to be non-spam, I will actually get those here wrong. These are my false negatives. So I will predict they are negative, but it's actually wrong. They are not negative, they are actually positives. On the other hand, if I predict everything to the right as spam, I will get some false positives. So these here, these are the ones that I predict as spam, but they are not spam. And these are the bad ones, right? Because these are the emails that we may miss because they're important emails and they could be accidentally moved to our spam inbox. So now I can actually shift my decision threshold, right? So I could move it more to the left here. So if I move it more to the left, I get more true positives, right? So everything in this region now, for the green one, will be true positive. So we increase the number of true positives. So it's just visualized by drawing an arrow up. However, at the same time, we also increase the number of false positives, right? Because now this one will be also now false positive. So we also increase the false positive rate with that. So true positive and false positives go both up. And this is basically an issue. If we go the other direction, if I go here, we reduce the number of false positives, but we also reduce the number of true positives. So then we get a higher number of false negatives. So in that case, there's always like a sweet spot between the two. So in this case, a good spot would have been the original one, but depending on the application, maybe I want to reduce the number of false positives, So I could, for example, in the spam classification example, try to get almost zero false positives. I get fewer true positives, so I get more spam in my inbox, but then I avoid having important emails accidentally landing in my spam folder. So we will later in this lecture take a look at the receiver operator characteristic, which plots the false positive rate and the true positive rate for different decision thresholds. So it's moving around the decision thresholds and plots a curve where we have the true positive rate versus the false positive rate, and then we can then see how it looks like, and then we can compute the area under the curve, which can sometimes be helpful if you don't have a particular threshold in mind and you want to compare different models to each other. Then you can look at the models for different decision thresholds. It's also sometimes helpful to have a fairer comparison, but more about that later. So just to finish up the confusion matrix lecture here or video, like I mentioned before, we can also construct confusion matrices for more than two classes. So here I have a case where I have three classes, like in the Iris dataset. So now it's a little bit more tricky to talk about positive and negative labels, because it's not immediately obvious what is the positive label. We can define one and then label everything as non-positive, that is not the positive label. But in general, usually when we have something like this, we work with it directly without reducing it to a binary problem. So here, for example, in the Iris case, we would have three classes like Versicolor, Virginica, and Setosa. And in ML Extend and in scikit-learn, if you just use the confusion matrix function, it will work out of the box here. So here that's actually for four classes. I should mention this is actually the confusion matrix from ML Extend, because there is an option that you can choose. It's called binary. So if you choose this binary option here, it will reduce the confusion matrix from the multi-class to binary. I should have included more information, because there's an option that you can set to choose which one is the positive class. So I think in this case, class label 1 should be the positive class. So class label 1 will be the positive class and everything else will be the negative class. I should have added more information about that. In any case, so you can reduce a multi-class classification class to a binary one. And if you want to toy around with the code examples, they are all on GitHub. Okay, but then let's finish this video on confusion matrices. There's actually not much to it. It's like this matrix showing you the predicted versus the actual classes. And in the next video, we will take a look at some other metrics called precision recall and F1 score, which are also commonly used in addition to, let's say, the number of true positives and so forth. Okay, so then see you back in the next video.